This is how we perform the monitoring of a trace. You see that we did not run into any leaf whose right-hand side is empty. This means that the property is not true right away. We can move the right-hand side of the remaining two leaves to their empty left-hand side and use these two leaves as the starting point for a next round of decomposition awaiting for a new message. In the following, we'll call these two leaves the witnesses. Okay. In this algorithm, the state of the protocol is a set of nodes. The two remaining leaves are, in fact, the next state of the protocol computed from the start state at the top. So we can say that this algorithm computes the transition function delta. Given a set of nodes and a message, we produce a decomposition tree, and the leaves that we don't discard at the end are the new state. But actually, we do more than compute the next state of the protocol, because the sequence of decompositions tell us how we conclude that from the start state and the current message, the resulting nodes are the next state. It follows that this algorithm can also be used to compute the proof we are looking for. It suffices to remember the path from the root to each leaf, and this path can be concisely described by simply listing the decomposition rules performed at each step. For example, to get to the leftmost leaf, we first decompose the G operator, then the conjunction, then we use the decomposition rule for the OR operator, and since this rule produces two child nodes, we say we take the left branch, then the X operator, and finally, we evaluate P on the current message, and since P is true, we get to the leaf. And notice how on the left of the picture, we listed the sequence of decomposition rules we used to get to that leaf. In any decomposition tree, the sequence is unique, and we can keep in the proof the contents of the leaf we arrive to. To describe the rightmost leaf, we can do a similar process and say that the proof that these two leaves are the next state is encoded by the expression at the left. Then using this algorithm, we have all we need to evaluate the function gamma, which produces the next state of the protocol and the proof. Okay, now we move to the function new, which is computed on the server side. Now remember that its goal is for the server to discover if the message it receives or the proof itself has been spoofed in any way. By spoofed here, we mean that the proof would trick the server into accepting a message that it shouldn't, for example, by asserting things that are not true of the message. This can be easily checked by making sure that all the basic expressions, so the atoms P and Q, that occur in the proof are actually true in the message as the proof stipulates. So we just evaluate the basic expressions occurring in the proof against the message and make sure that they fit, so to speak. Finally, what remains to be done is to compute function new, which is the function used by the server to derive the next state of the protocol. Remember that the next state of the protocol is already included in the proof at the end of the list of decomposition rules leading to each leaf. So in fact, we don't need to compute the next state, we just need to be convinced that what is written there is indeed the next state, which is different. So how can we be convinced? Well, starting from the current state of the protocol, what we can do is to check if the list of decomposition rules given in the proof actually fits with the current state. That is, if we can indeed decompose our actual state using the rules and in the order given by the list. Let's see what happens if we take the first list in the proof. The list starts with a G, and indeed the top operator of our formula is a G, so we can strip it from the formula. Then the lists contain a conjunction, and the next topmost operator of the formula is also a conjunction. Now, in the case of a conjunction, we must still keep both sides of the operator in our node, so we just remove the operator, and in this case, replace it by a comma. Then the list contains the OR operator, and its subscript label 1 says that we keep the left-hand side of the OR. There is indeed a formula with an OR in the node, and we remove it and the right-hand side, and we keep the left. Now, you probably get the idea here, and we can continue with the X, and then the P, and we realize that we exhausted the list of decomposition rules given in the proof and ended up with an empty left-hand side. And we decide that it's enough to accept the last bit of the proof containing the node contents as the node resulting from these decomposition. Of course, we would do the same thing with the second half of the proof to accept the second node. And what's nice about this is that we obtain the next state of the protocol without actually computing it. We use the information in the proof as a guide to quickly accept the answer that's already provided there. One reason why this is quick is that we only consider branches that lead to actual nodes. You might recall that in the decomposition tree, there was actually one more branch which ended in a contradiction. And this branch is not included in the proof. Therefore, if the number of witnesses is much smaller than the total number of branches in the decomposition tree, then the time taken to evaluate function nu on the server will be shorter than the time required by the client to compute the proof using function gamma, since the server is spared from all the dead-end branches that gamma still has to expand. However, if the number of witnesses is not really smaller than the total number of branches, the server isn't spared of much work. And this means that in that case, checking the proof is not significantly quicker than computing it in the first place. But since the goal of cooperative runtime monitoring is precisely to spare time on the server, then we don't gain much by doing this. There are a couple of solutions to this problem. The one we present here is pretty drastic. We'll restrict ourselves to LTL formulas where we are guaranteed that any decomposition leads to at most one witness at every step. This is, of course, a subset or a fragment of the logic LTL, and I'll call it non-branching LTL. There are only three restrictions we impose on an LTL formula to be part of the non-branching fragment. The first is that if you have a disjunction, then at least one side of the disjunction is free of any temporal operator, so you can only have Boolean connectives and atoms. The second restriction is that if you have an F operator, then inside you must not have any temporal operator. In other words, what's inside the F is again only Boolean connectives. And finally, when you have the until operator, then the left and the right side must be free of temporal operators. I won't explain here where these restrictions come from and why they are necessary, but if you look at the paper, you'll see the proof that a formula that follows these restrictions indeed has proofs where only one branch leads to a witness every time. And this gives us the condition we want, namely that checking the proof will be much easier than computing it in the first place. I developed a prototype implementation of this concept in Java, where you give an LTL specification to both a client process and a server process, and both sides perform the computation I've just described each time a message is sent or received. For example, when the client sends a message, it is first processed by the client-side monitor that computes gamma, the gamma function, and produces the next state and proof as we have shown. On average, for the examples I've tested, it takes about 5 milliseconds per message to do this computation. Then the message and the proof are relayed to the server-side monitor, which computes gamma and nu to derive the next state of the protocol. And on average, for the same message, it takes 0.35 milliseconds to do it. This is more than 10 times faster in this example. So it means that in this context, the server is spared of as much as 90% of processing time while retaining the same guarantees over the compliance to the contract than if it had monitored the whole thing by itself. Now remember the graph I've shown you in the beginning where we plotted client-side and server-side monitoring according to the guarantees they give to the server versus the computational savings. I said that if there was a plateau at the top left of the plot, this is the area that presented potential for cooperative monitoring. Now, what we discovered from the experiments is that there is indeed a plateau, and this plateau goes as far as right as 90% of computational savings before leaving the horizontal line of complete guarantees. This is just another way of representing what I just said. But remember also that to do so, we had to restrict the language we used. We had to use a subset of all possible LTL formulas if we wanted to ensure that the proofs were short enough to be worth the trouble of doing this. So actually, there is a third dimension to the graph, which is the expressiveness of the language we use. The curve that's shown there applies to non-branching LTL, but we know that if we use a logic that is more expressive, such as the full LTL, then the plateau is smaller, since some proofs can be almost as long to check as to compute. And if we use first-order logic, which is even more expressive than LTL, chances are that this plateau is even smaller. What's nice is that the ridge of all these slices follows some curve that represents for each of these languages the theoretical upper bound in computational savings that you can achieve through cooperative runtime monitoring. And that's one nice idea that would be worth studying in the future. Okay, that's enough for today. Now let's conclude with a couple of take-home points to tell your grandma. First of all, we've seen that an interface contract is a way of specifying valid sequences of messages between a client and a server. And we know that this general terminology can be mapped to concepts in different contexts, such as object-oriented programming or web services. Second, the point of this talk was to present cooperative runtime monitoring, where the enforcement of this contract is split between the client and the server. If we restrict ourselves, 90% of the monitoring work can be outsourced to the client. And the nice part about this is that we keep the same guarantees on the server regarding contract compliance. And finally, we've just seen that this is a three-dimensional problem, which means that we can modulate these three factors. We can decide to surrender part of our guarantees or to accept lesser computational savings or trade these two things for a richer language. And all these three factors are interdependent. So this is just one solution for this whole three-dimensional problem. So this is it. Thank you for your attention. And if you'd like to know more about this or other parts of my work, please visit my website where you can read most of my research papers, including this one. So bye-bye.